bother you. I will never promise to. I will never follow you. I will never bother you. Never say a word again. I will crawl away for good. I will move away from here. You won't be afraid of fear. Nothing was put into this. And always knew it would come to this. Things have never been so swell. I have never found a well.
We are here with the next episode of the Popcorn Panel Podcast.
Oh, now you don't sound brain dead, David. I had to introduce last night, and now you feel good enough to do it this time? You're not brain dead yet?
Well, first of all,
I'm brain dead. Walt, what else is new?
First of all, I didn't know you were going to do the introductions, and second, I was completely exhausted last week.
Yeah. Finnegan, I was kind of too.
Yes.
And I was sweating like a hyena because of Norv.
Yeah, screw that movie with 87 minutes of time I'll never get back.
You're welcome.
Yeah, you're the one who introduced me to movies, so.
Well, somebody had to.
So.
What's wrong with you, David? What are you doing?
Wait. What the? Okay, zoom in. Thank you. I'm gonna have nightmares tonight.
I'm gonna make sure maybe that gets a picture.
Do I have hair here?
You have a mustache.
A beard? Ahem. Allow
that's
me to
not
show
a
you
beard.
What...
This is a beard, dumb shit.
I meant hair, mustache.
This is a real beard.
No, this is a beard. Look. All of that. Right there.
Rumor has this on Latino. It's been rumored that Latinos have possibly one of the greatest beards ever.
Oh, Jesus.
Imagine if I did not save November.
Huh?
I said, imagine if I did not save November.
Speak up! I can't hear you!
No shade. Not November. There's kids watching this, by the way.
I said, no save November.
No shame, November. You're like the people on the Today Show. Are you going to be like Matt Lauer after he got fired?
You're fired.
You're fired.
Okay, Trump. But anyway.
Hey, no politics.
Hey.
No.
Hey, not on my watch.
Thanks.
It's my show, David. You better behave.
It's The Apprentice. But anyway, Victor, you could go ahead.
What do you mean? You go ahead. You usually do introductions. I'm telling you now, you're not brain dead. That's all I'm saying. You can do whatever you want.
All right, I'll go. Welcome to episode number 5.
I thought it was 5, not 6.
Cinco is 5.
Oh, great. Cinco. It's Cinco de Mayo, everybody. Everybody have tacos.
Actually, you know what? Today is Mexican Independence Day.
Oh, my God.
Hey.
I'm not joking.
Also, this episode airs on Tuesdays, so you can have tacos anyway. And I mean, I'm just having this right now.
I thought that was Doritos, not Fritos.
It is.
At least that's the funny thing is.
Oh my God! Another.
You know
line.
What that reminds me of? It reminds me of one of the movies on the wheel. I won't say what it is, but the Fritos you have reminds me of a movie on the wheel. I'll keep it at that.
Speaking of the movie that we pick on the wheel, we got us up a good one. Finally.
What do you mean? The last, except for episode 4, we have all been good movies. What are you talking about? You're full of shit.
Well, look at last week.
Yeah, but before, what do we watch? Twister. And you liked Twister.
Monsters Inc. We did Monsters Inc. and Star Wars.
What the hey, look fuck at that. Is There's on me. My screen?
Yeah, it's me, Kermit the Frog.
Bob Chapek, please don't sue us, please.
God.
Anyway, this is episode number 5.
Yeah, thanks a lot for firing Steve Whitmire. Even though it was higher up. Actually, it was the Jim Henson Company that did that.
Well, that wasn't Disney, because technically Jim Henson Company is an independent studio, not carried by Disney.
Who knows? And it's currently nighttime right now, Friday night Saturday morning, 12:30 in the morning.
It's 12:30 in the morning. Why am I filming at 12:30 in the morning? David, why are you still up? You gotta go to bed.
Let's get on with the introductions. You have this person, Abara.
If you're wondering why I'm in a good mood, well, after that disastrous movie that we watched last week, and we actually picked a good movie this time, I'm glad that I saw this movie. This was the perfect palate cleanser.
See, Victor, this is how we make people stay positive.
What are you talking about?
That's a line from the movie.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
Because bad movies make people depressed, but good movies make people stay positive.
Okay, Mrs. O.
Jesus! Oh. Well, there goes my happy mood. Actually, literally, there goes my happy mood because my topic for tonight.
What are we doing? What am I doing? Why am I the only one there? What happened to everybody? What happened? I'm here all by myself. Uh-oh. Screw me! Who's controlling that bitch? Who? Did you put that? You didn't fucking scare me one bit.
If Jordan was here, he'll be dying.
Not a pussy.
That's what she said.
I like some getting some licking.
Y'all need problems. You need help.
And we have picture.
Well, looks like I changed my outlook on movies. Hey, maybe some people actually do like certain movies that other people hate. It's all about, for example, some people love the Disney remix. Others hate the Disney remix. It's all about your own personal perspective. It doesn't matter what you feel about it. It doesn't matter if you loved it or hated it. There's going to be somebody who feels the same way you do, give or take, about certain movies. Like, certain people are actually, say, for example, love the Lion King remake, like me. Others don't, and that's okay. It's just that we can't be so toxic about it on social media.
Thank you.
It's called being wise. It's called being respectful and not letting social media get you down in terms of your opinion. It's okay to have a different voice. It's okay. It is perfectly fine. The only time where shit like that is unnecessary, you know, in terms of like opinions and all that, is for movies that are built off of hatred. Look at you, Darren Aronofsky. And Lars von Trier. Other than that, everything else is fair game. Just be respectful to each other. Don't let other people's opinions influence you. Judge it by what you think.
Yeah, what is words respectful? Wisdom.
Also, watch
wisdom on this age? That's funny.
Me Yoda? Or Yoda, I am.
I agree.
Also, I sound.
Also, watch the movie before I give a review on that.
People just need to lose some common sense. That's all. Just don't influence on social media. In fact, I would argue, in terms of your opinions on movies, that's fine. But you know what? Get off Twitter. Get off Facebook. Actually watch the movie and just leave it at that. If you don't want to, if you think that an opinion is going to hurt you, don't post it.
If you can't say anything nice, don't say anything at all.
Sometimes it is best to say nothing at all. But you know what? Let's just put it this way. In terms of certain movies people like, like certain minority likes that others, a majority hates, you're not alone. That's all I'm saying. You're not alone. There are somebody in this world that likes a certain movie that you do as well. See, I'm more wiser than most people in this freaking film community.
Me and Ibarra are twins now.
And I literally had this brain exercise earlier today to kind of, you know, identify that kind of stuff. And there are good movies that come out these days. It's just about perspective and about what you're looking for.
I hate every single one of you.
Lego's full of shit. And I'm kidding.
It's my hobby. Well, it's my second hobby.
What's your first hobby?
You know what it is.
That's nasty.
I love messing with David.
PSA announcement. If anybody tells me to go to bed, you go to bed.
I'm using my big brain. But I'm not going to use my big brain when I announce this.
You're fine.
And Bozos, we reviewed possibly one of the worst trilogies that Disney has made yet. There are Disney Channel exclusives, and I didn't like the first one. I hated the second one. The third one was the freaking chore to go through. And now they're gonna be making a fourth one. Descendants 4 is gonna be a thing. Special thanks, Tana, for this topic.
How are they gonna do it? Most of them wanted to drop out.
Actually, you know what? Essie is getting backlash.
I thought the other Dove Cameron, she's doing bigger and better things. So is Sophia Carson. So what are they? What are they? Who are they, like? What? What's the point of making another one?
And well, one actor, which Cameron Boyce, he passed away.
Unfortunately.
So why
so
bother
what
making
the hell are they gonna do? What are they even gonna do?
It doesn't matter if you're either gonna recast him or saying that oh he moved on to some other place. Fuck that shit. Making a sequel with okay, I will say this. I'm not a big fan of Cameron Boyce, and I most certainly did not like him in that movie, but I can kind of understand what he was doing. He's basically the heart and soul of the movies. Again, I don't like him, but at least I kind of understand his character traits. But since he passed away, why make another one? That's like making
a sequel. Also, like I said, the other three that are still surviving, they're doing other things now. Look at Dove Cameron. She has a fucking singing career now. She has a hit song or something. And she did that movie Vengeance earlier this year.
That's the one with BJ.
Yeah, BJ Novak from The Office.
Which I actually heard that one's a good movie.
I haven't seen it yet. And David, stop being like SML, please. Please. Stop being SML. Please.
What?
And then Sophia Carson earlier this year had Purple Hearts, which I didn't really care for, but it was a hit on Netflix. It's like a romance military thing. I thought it wasn't really that good, but I could understand what they were going for with that one.
So yeah, pretty much like making a that's like you're making a sequel of Mrs. Doubtfire without Robin Williams. It just
doesn't make sense.
It's disgraceful. You're ruining a legacy. I don't care if you're
I personally believe that maybe what they're trying to do, they're gonna do like have what I think they might do in terms of what they want to do for the characters in four. Maybe they're gonna put some of the supporting cast from these three movies and make them the main characters now, and make it about them. I think that might be what they're doing. That's just my guess.
I mean, that might be plausible.
I wonder if Kenny Ortega's even gonna do it again.
Oh God! And not that Andy Fuckman was one of the worst directors ever.
Kenny Ortega.
The only thing I ever liked of him is that Michael Jackson movie. The rest.
This is it. It's awful. Actually a pretty good film.
It's a very good documentary. The rest. Not one movie did was good.
To be fair, he did the choreography for Dirty Dancing. So he did something right. Even though he didn't direct that movie, he did that. He did the choreographed the dances for that. We gotta give him credit.
And that fucker got a freaking Hollywood halt. Like, he got a star. Why?
I hope it's not because of Hocus Pocus. Please. Oh my God.
Speaking of which, right now we're talking about D23, and they also mentioned Hocus Pocus.
Well, that's going to come out next week here. God. Yeah, Hocus Pocus 2 comes out next week. Great.
Around the same time Descendants 4 was announced. For me, it's not that I'm upset that they're making another one without Cameron Boyce. I mean, that's beside the point. I mean, that's not why I'm angry. I'm angry that they're making another one. Who is asking for more of these?
I will tell you, there is a cult following for this. Believe it or not, there is. Like,
okay,
this reinvention type stuff of the Disney characters. Although I think, even though I don't really care for the show either, I think Once Upon a Time did this a little bit better.
They reinvented
the Disney characters. That lasted for several years, and that has a cult following.
You want to know good like cult following movie? Nightmare Before Christmas in a way. And The Big Lebowski.
There could be a couple of others too.
Space Jam in a way.
The first one. Not the second one. I mean, some people probably like the second one. It's okay. That's fine. But, you know, it's mostly when you see, you know, nobody really likes that movie all that much. It's just basically mainly the fan base is for the first movie.
Mm-hmm.
But Descendants 4, I don't know how they're going to do this. Didn't they end their story in 3? I haven't seen 2 or 3, but didn't they end the story with 3?
Yeah, they did. And they ended in a stupid... I mean, Tanner said it best. The ending was stupid, but at least it's an ending.
So there's no cliffhanger line. That stupid cliffhanger angle, that wasn't the end of the story. This is the end.
Every time they do those fucking cliffhangers, I will always get
did
pissed.
Did 3 have a cliffhanger?
No.
Okay, so they ended properly. That's the end. That's what they wanted to do for their trilogy. They're done. And now they're going to make another one.
It should stay a trilogy. I don't know why.
Maybe what they're trying to do here is that they're trying to introduce these characters in the 4th movie and then make this a television series, maybe?
Oh, for God's sakes. Oh, sure.
Potentially for Disney Plus? Oh, I'm not sure. This is only my guess.
That's another guess. They're milking
it. It's a backdoor pilot, possibly. That's my guess.
Yeah, they're freaking milking it as this franchise. I don't know why it's a franchise. I think it's one of the worst franchises ever.
Money, look at the first one. The first one was like one of the highest rated DCOMs of all time. Like in terms of ratings. And the kids, even though we don't like these movies, I've seen the first one. I hate the first one. The first one is not that good.
It's on my top 5 worst movies of 2015.
It's a good concept. Don't get me wrong. The concept's there. It's just that I think it would have been better if it had been a theatrical release, not shilling to the Disney Channel, and having better writing, and not be a musical. I think it could have worked. The idea could have worked. Again, Once Upon a Time did this too. But that had a bigger budget because it was on ABC, so it was a network show, so it was a bigger budget, so...
Oh my god. When I saw the first one, I absolutely hated it. Okay, the only positive I had in this movie was Kristen Chenoweth, and that's basically it.
Oh my god, she wasn't that good, in my opinion. She was just hamming it up. I thought the movie Maleficent wasn't good.
well, that one was also mixed. And then when I saw the second one, wow. I will dare say it's one of the worst sequels I've ever seen in my life.
It's anti-Empire Strikes Back. It's the anti... Isn't that the one where the really bad CGI water comes into play? CGI water. Oh my goodness. You're going to make the Little Mermaid remake look pretty good. I actually think that movie has potential. Believe it or not, I think it could be good. We just have to keep... I'm having an open mind about the remake. Open mind. Keep an open mind. Another thing, folks. Keep an open mind about certain movies. And watch what you're interested in. If it has you interested, go ahead and watch it. Like me.
And me.
And then shut up, SML. Shut up, Logan.
hey, Logan. Good luck with your kid. I can't wait to see how much of a poor father you're gonna be. Sorry, asshole.
I have a feeling like Descendants 4. Like, did they introduce any characters from the last movie that they could be in this one?
I think they did. I think. Oh wait, Hades was there.
I'm talking. Did he have a kid or something too?
In the third one, Hades is basically Dove Cameron's daughter.
What the? That's like the most weird ass. And then Maleficent and Hades. I don't see the comp. Is this supposed to be like some twist? Like it's I Am Your Father.
I'm your father.
The writings of these movies are so goddamn terrible. And yes, I get it's a TV movie, but at least make. Okay, you want to know what is a good TV movie? Hey Arnold, the Jungle Movie.
I was gonna. The funny thing is that the actual original Hey Arnold movie was also gonna be a TV movie. It was made as a TV movie, but then Paramount decided, hey, we're gonna put it in theaters.
The Jungle Movie was supposed to be theatrical. However, because of the first movie was such a flop, they said to cancel that movie.
But the first movie was supposed to be a TV movie too. The first movie was supposed to that. I just found this out recently. The first movie that was theatrically released was supposed to be a TV movie, but then they decided let's make a couple bucks and put it in theaters, and it was successful because it was such a small budget. And fun fact for the day. Another TV movie that's apparently really good. Like, who's the other one that was saying that was a TV movie that was really good? I heard that Cinderella one for the 90s was pretty good. With Brandy. I heard that was pretty good.
How much was the budget?
The budget for Pretty Sentence?
I'm going to say thousands of dollars. It's not in the millions.
And it really shows.
Like, literally, there's episodes of The Orville that look more expensive than this. Then again, that's a higher budgeted show, so what am I talking about? Lifetime movies sometimes look a little bit more professional than this movie. Yeah, I go in that far.
And that's only a fraction of how bad the third one was. If people say Shrek the Third is one of the worst on third installments, no.
Shrek the Third is actually not that bad, but I'll get to that someday. I just think that movie's mediocre. I don't think it's horrible.
It's one of those movies where after watching this movie, I just felt just sad, wondering what went wrong. What happened?
Sentence 3 was the whole thing was wrong. From the beginning, it was wrong.
Oh my god, these are one of the reasons why I don't like musicals.
I don't like musicals either, but they can be done right. Look at In the Heights. A couple others that I like. It's just with this, I feel like those movies, I don't think were meant to be musicals. I think they should have been regular, straightforward, sci-fi, fantasy, drama type stuff. And not musicals. But because it's Kenny Ortega, we gotta put that in.
Imagine if I made plush videos.
Your plus size?
Oh my god. David, you need to lose weight.
You know,
go on skinny. Weight Watchers if you have to.
I'm skinny, so I'm good.
Me too.
Need I say more?
What are you talking about? So in terms of what I think they can do for Descendants 4, because the first one, from what I remember, had a couple of characters that they didn't really focus on. But, like, for example, I think maybe, I mean, I heard she was the villain, the third one, too. The freaking Sleeping Beauties, whatever, grandniece or whatever. I think she was the bad person. If she turned good at the end, maybe they'll focus on her.
Who knows?
But again, I haven't seen 3. So, I don't know what I'm talking about. Maybe we should do a popcorn panel because I haven't seen 2 or 3. I've seen the first one, but it's been so long.
Oh, God. Well, we did a reaction of that on Bozos, and I was suffering. I did it on my birthday of all days.
You poor fucker. Oh, wow. That's something. You know what's saying something? I'm going to compare this to another Disney Channel original movie. The zombie trilogy looks better in terms of budget, than Descendants ever did. Especially the second one and the third one. The third one was so much bigger budgeted that they decided to put on Disney Plus first before it aired on the channel, apparently. Those zombies movies, I heard they're not that great. They're also musicals, but if I'm willing to do a made-for-TV movie, maybe we should do those.
Yeah, well, you know what? Many people love me suffering from Descendants, so probably we should do the entire
trilogy. And the zombies also has a bit of a cult following, too. I mean, why'd they make 3 of them? But luckily, I think they're leaving that off with 3. It's supposed to be the last one, so they knew when to stop. This one, I think it's because Descendants is one of their biggest cash cow franchises because the dolls sell very well. There's toy line. There's a toy line from Hasbro. I think it was Hasbro.
And it makes sense. I'll go as far as say it's one of the worst franchises of all time. It's right up there with the Purge movies, the Land for Time sequels, the
Blair Witch is the worst franchise of all time.
They're on par with Ice Age on how bad they are.
Shit, there's actually a couple of Ice Age movies that are good. Like
I only like two of them. I only like two of them. The first one and the third one. The rest, I freaking cannot stand them. I've never seen the fifth one, and I never will. That's a watching North is bad enough. Boy. And get Actually, I want to read this article. Descendants forecast. Dove Cameron has previously stated she will not film a Descendants movie.
Good, without Cameron Boyd. She could do better.
Then why make another one?
Good, she's doing better things. She has a singing career. She's acting in Vengeance and all the other stuff. Good for her. Good for her actually doing actually these real professional things. Support. Good.
What's the weirdest thing?
What?
These Disney Channel stars, they're better off or they're not at Disney.
Well, look at the guy. Cyrus, so. But in terms of like nowadays, look at them now. They're more successful now than they were back in the day when they got out of Disney. And they didn't get all coked up and shit.
That guy from, what's it called? Austin and Ally, the blonde guy.
He's in that Dahmer movie. I heard that was really good.
I heard it was amazing. And then that fat girl from Paul Blart 2. I know she was in Jurassic. I know she's in that Jurassic Park anime series, and I heard it was so Jurassic I heard World it was so good.
Camp Gracious, whatever that's called.
I heard that was so good.
Better ought to be better than Dominion.
And then that blonde chick from Jesse, she was in Cobra Kai.
Cobra Kai. Wood.
And then the little girl, she's a book author.
What?
That little girl from Jesse, she's a book writer now.
That's crazy.
Oh, very nice.
See, they're better, more successful now than they were back in the day. Good for them. They actually didn't go crazy.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
And
for that, Disney, the Dove Cam is probably one of the most successful now.
Disney are facing backlash after announcing a brand new Descendants film following the death of Cameron Boyce in 2019. There is no denying that the Descendants movies are one of the most beloved franchises. Sure, beloved.
I'm telling you, the kids love them. Regardless of what we think about them, there is an audience for them. And I understand why they might want to. Remember, nobody sets out to do a bad movie. It's just that this is made for television. They can't do all the stuff they want to do because it's made for television.
Most beloved franchises. Okay, so you're basically shaming on Star Wars, the MCU. Okay, I see. Okay, I see.
They're not shaming anybody, as far as I'm concerned, because we know that the Star Wars and MCU franchises are like right here. Although the MCU has been kind of divided lately, but a lot of people still like it. It's right up here with Star Wars. Descendants is right mid tier, like this.
They're below right where Land for Time or the Purge movies.
Before Time.
I'll go as far. They're just as bad as those franchises.
Before Time. That's funny. Little
God, Foot. I freaking hate those movies.
Little Foot should eat them.
If that were to happen, I would at least give this movie a thumbs up.
Oh, read the article. Come on.
Yeah, most beloved franchises. Yeah, that's like saying Attack of the Clones is the best Star Wars movie.
Far from it.
Ever since the first movie came out in 2015, fans have adored the way Descendants 2 and Descendants 3. Imagine what children of icon and favorite villains would be like. Essentially the Camp Rock and High School Musical of their generation. And they're just as bad, if not worse. They're worse than the movies.
I think the Camp Rock movies are worse than the Descendants movies. I'm going that far. I think the Camp Rock movies are the bottom of the barrel. They're the bottom of the barrel. Have you seen those?
I've seen bits and pieces of it. And
they are the bottom of the barrel. They're worse than the Descendants. I'm going that far. At least they have a concept there that's interesting. Camp Rock has nothing. In my opinion, it's not for me.
I hated those freaking Disney Channel movies since I was a kid.
There are a couple of them that are actually pretty good. Look at The Color of Friendship. If you ever go on Disney Plus and look for The Color of Friendship, that's really good.
On top of that, the movies have helped turn the cast into household names. The same way ScarJo started her acting role in North.
Again, they're doing better things now. Thank God.
All three films today star Dove Cameron. Cameron Boyce, Booba Stewart.
Booba Stewart was in fucking Twilight, so he was successful before this movie, but he was in fucking Twilight. Wow, it's like going from rock bottom to go like this. I hope he gets out of there alive and does something good one of these days.
Sophia, well, we just mentioned Sophia Carson and China Ann McClain also appear in the later films. Descendants have now announced they're making Descendants 4, but will be the first film without Cameron Boyce. Will Doug Cameron be in Descendants 4? Cameron Boyce fans call out Disney for making Descendants 4 without him. The movie was confirmed at D23 Expo over the weekend. Dove, Sophia, Boo Boo, and all decided not to return for the fourth film. Then again, good. Why make a fourth one?
I'm happy for him. I'm happy for him. Get out as soon as you can.
Oh my god. I'm getting freaking flashbacks of the Buckwild Ice Age movie.
But that was an entire studio. This is just three actors.
Wow.
Literally, none of the actors returned. Only Simon Pegg.
Simon Pegg, poor fucker. He deserves better.
Oh, yeah.
Come on. Yeah, you're better than this, man. See it. However, China McClain is back at Zuma.
There you go. There's gonna be I didn't know she turned good eventually, but I guess she's gonna be the protagonist now. Uma, yeah. Or whatever her name is.
Yeah, she turned good in the third one. I was like, are you fucking kidding?
Okay, she's the protagonist. There you go.
So basically you're treating it like Dragon Ball. Like every villain turns out to be a friend of the main character. Come on. Oh yeah. Dragon Ball Evolution is not considered a Disney movie. That's what Disney it is evil a Disney indeed. Movie.
Because Fox.
What does the Fox say?
So yeah, we got I her back. Innocence. Do we have anybody else coming back or?
And it says the film will focus on new characters that Red, the daughter of the Queen of Hearts, and Chloe, the daughter of Cinderella, played by Kylie Cantrell and Dara Renee. Okay, so why are you calling it Descendants 4?
Wait.
If it's involving new characters.
What about some High School Musical, the musical, the series? God help me. That show's fucking terrible.
When your show is so bad that even the title is fucked up and botched.
I don't like that show. I'm sorry. More power to you if you do, but I don't like it.
I don't like High School Musical.
So pretty much what they're trying to do is The Force Awakens. That's pretty much what they're trying to do here. New characters and then having some old establishing characters as supporting roles. It's The Force Awakens.
But here's the thing. The Force Awakens actually did it like beautifully.
And Ghostbusters Afterlife in some way they did it too.
Yeah, I mean, look at the
Scream 6! That's Scream 5. It's not Scream 6. Scream 6 comes out next year. Scream 5! Scream 5, not Scream 6. Scream 6 comes out next year. Damn it. So, now we know. It's going to be one of those. It's going to be a legacy sequel, even though the movies aren't even that old.
Yeah, calling this in his legacy. Yeah, a little piece of me died.
I mean, it's been like 7 years since the franchise started, so it's barely counts as a legacy sequel.
God, 7 years.
The only good thing about the first Descendants is that song at the end, that Shawn Mendes song. It actually is better. It should have been used in a different movie. That song's not that bad because it's not a musical number. We should have used it for another film.
You see, and then it also says, when asked by Papa's earlier this year, if she do a Descendants reboot, Dove said, I'm gonna say no because I don't think it would be the same without the whole original cast. It would be different. It would just be different now, and also we did it. We told a full story. We completed it.
There you go.
If Dove Cameron says that the story is done, why make another one? I'm going to keep asking the same question.
This is the end of the story. This is not the end of the story. Don't pull that sequel bait bullshit like you always do.
God, every time they do that, I always just want to punch a wall.
Give me more details.
It is the end. The end. They probably had it on the last one. They actually had a title card that said the end. Wow, I'm surprised they're even going forward with a fourth movie. It's kind of shocking to me that they are. You would think that maybe Disney Channel would kind of move on and do something else. Because Zombies is over, Descendants is over, you gotta figure out your next new franchise. But, I don't know. I guess it just makes the money. But even with that, there's fans of it. Maybe people want to clamor to see that kind of stuff.
God, I swear to God. If you like a movie, then that's fine. But Descendants? Hell no. Give me reasons why you like this movie. Go ahead.
I'm going to say it on behalf of the fans. I'm sorry. He's being mean. He's being mean to you. I'm sorry.
No, fuck them. I freaking hate them.
One of the worst movies I've ever seen. I'm talking about it.
Oh my God. Don't I've be never so been so excited. Furious over a freaking announcement.
Wow.
Even I'm still debating if I should do a review of it on freaking Bozos.
You know because what? Maybe you won't have other choice. We'll do it on this show.
Even better, because we're going to do Glitter next.
Can't wait.
Yeah, speaking of musicals, oh boy.
God.
Glitter's not really a musical, though. It's more of a music film. It's not really a musical. I've seen it, so I can tell you it's not a musical. They just sing. Whenever they sing, they're doing music. They're performing music. It's not like it's going to be... You know, it's a musical number for the sake of it.
Oh, God, I swear.
Then it's 4. I can't wait to do it on the show. 2022,
2023, 2024,
let's go.
Oh, God. And I was really.
They're going to bring it next for the Disney characters. We're going to bring in Star Wars characters now. We're going to bring in MCU characters now, except they're going to be replaced by different actors.
Or better yet, bring in the freaking Ice Age characters while we're at it. If you want to milk franchises, or bring in Homer Simpson.
A live action version of Sid.
Oh, God. Oh, I said people love to jizz on Blue Sky. I mean, okay. They made some good movies, they made some bad movies.
Or
but
maybe what
them.
They could do for Descendants 4, they could put in the existing live action titles and connect them. Like put in the Santa Claus and put in Princess Diaries, put in Sky High.
Oh, look, oh my God.
The Pacifier, put in.
Oh God. I'm losing my mind.
Put in I'll Be Home for Christmas. Remember the Titans! Make the football team remember the Titans team!
Oh my God.
While you're at it, add the Touchstone movie so they can make Armageddon and have the actual asteroid from Armageddon as a character.
Will people want to see a Roger Rabbit sequel, which, how can you make a sequel to Roger Rabbit?
I think it can be, but it just has to be. It can be made, but it has to be under this got the a good director who knows what he's doing.
Well, you can't do a Roger Rabbit sequel now. Ever since Bob Hoskins, even we're talking about like a decade ago, he retired acting because of Parkinson's.
That's true.
And now since that he's passed, well, I'm too late. But my If people like this movie, I don't fucking get you.
It's fine, everybody. I'll be the simple-minded, open folk here.
Also, I'll even go as far. You got shit taste in movies.
Now I wouldn't say that, bro.
They freaking wear costumes on the characters. You gotta be pissing me.
They probably do it as cosplay. There's cosplayers out there, you know.
Shame on all I gotta say is shame on you. Hide in shame. Go to the doghouse so they will treat you poorly like in Call of the Wild.
No, treat you poorly like to an old Yeller. Speaking of old Yeller, right. Bring him back from the dead and put him in Descendants 4.
Oh, God, this fucking movie.
I can put all this conspiracy shit in here. There's no limits.
Well, Romy is the happy Madison. Descendants is just with me.
Oh my God. I hate this friend. I hate the first one. That's all I've seen. I can't comment on two or three.
the two and three, they're all there. They're one of the worst sequels of all time. They're on par with Paul Mark 2.
Oh my fucking god. Oh, wow.
And I was suffering. And I was suffering from the second one.
It has a good idea. Don't get me wrong. It's just about the execution. And I guess for you, the execution didn't work.
The execution, it literally was an execution. It was it literally just, boom, it died. All hoping humanity is all gone.
All this right. Leads me to question who's gonna be the villain for Descendants 4? Who haven't they used yet? Who the fuck did they not use yet? Let's see. Let's use Frodo. Frollo from the Hunchback of Notre Dame. Let's bring him in. Let's make it all
up. Yeah, speaking of hellfire, this movie should burn in hell.
So much fun.
I'm freaking dreading. I freaking hate these franchises. I don't get why people like them. If you like them, give me reasons why. Don't freaking say, oh, you just don't get it. It's made for kids. Give me actual reasons.
We're going to put, you know what? Because of all you're saying about these Disney Channel original movies, we're going to put fucking zombies on the wheel right now. We're going to put it tonight. We're going to put zombies on the fucking wheel. We're going to do this trilogy. We're going to do that trilogy too. We're going to put zombies on the wheel.
The entire movies?
No, just the first one, and then we can go from there. We're putting zombies on the wheel. No, I'm just kidding. Well, I am willing to do it. I'm going to do it, but not right now. Maybe in October.
Oh, yeah, sure, because of Halloween season.
Exactly. That's what I'm thinking. Put it in October. I'm going to put zombies in October. So, yeah, is that all you got to say about that? You have anything more to say?
All I got to say is I am dreading for the fourth one.
Don't worry, you have me.
It's going to be the next Ice Age 4.
I'll watch it with you. It's okay. We have our back. I would cue the Friends theme song, but I don't want Warner Brothers to sue me.
Because I got a copyright claim from the Les Bozos episode.
Oh, God. And sometime for...
Okay.
Line me up.
So, tonight, before we recorded this and I watched tonight's movie, I watched another film started in the evening, and it's Baz Luhrmann's new film Elvis, which is a biopic obviously of the life of Elvis Presley, as well as about his relationship with his manager Colonel Tom Parker. With Baz Luhrmann movies, if you've ever seen any of his movies, you know that this guy has a style. It's very flashy. His films are, you love them or you hate them because of how flashy they are. With me, I've only seen a handful of his films. Romeo and Juliet was very good with Leonardo DiCaprio. Because it fit with the tone, because the setting was in present day. Even though it was all the Shakespeare freaking dialogue, the soundtrack and all that shit is fantastic, and the way they did it was actually pretty good. And that's really the only one I've seen. But with Elvis, he puts his style, and it's a biopic, obviously, about Elvis Presley. I feel this is already a contender. Excuse me. This is already a contender for one of the best films of the year. It's really, really, really good.
Wow.
First and foremost, I want to get to the performances first and foremost, because the main actor, Austin Butler, who actually was in a Disney Channel original movie, he was in Sharpay's Fabulous Adventure, the spinoff to High School Musical. Funny thing, we mentioned that, we go for him, and he's doing more successful things after the Disney Channel.
More of the story, kids. If you want to be an actor, don't work at... Okay, I want to say don't work at Disney. Just, if you want to work at Disney, do some voice acting. It'll save you a ton.
Yeah, voice acting.
But Austin Butler's Listen, I didn't see an actor playing Elvis in this movie. I saw him as Elvis. He was Elvis in this film. He got the accent down. He got the moves down. He got the singing down. He was magnificent. He's one of the best performances of the year. Tom Hanks as Colonel Tom Parker. This is the first time, it's the first time he's ever played a villain before. Because this guy was not a very nice dude.
Well, technically, like, in the first Toy Story, Woody was almost going to be a villain.
They changed it. Thank you, Whedon. You have Whedon to thank for that.
And the movie was almost canceled.
It's true. But the thing is about Tom Hanks' performance, that he's still the same charismatic, he's still his charismatic self, but he's also playing a complete asshole. So it's very different from him, and it's for him, and it's very much the same for him. But he's magnificent. You really hate this guy. Like, absolutely just hate this guy. It's just the way, like, literally, you would think it would be so hard to hate Tom Hanks. Because Tom Hanks, he's a fucking saint, man. Let's face it.
He's one of the greatest actors in life.
He does a great job of making you hate him.
I mean, Tom Hanks, okay, here's the thing with Tom Hanks. He's been some bad movies. I mean, the Da Vinci Code movies, I heard there were
The Robert Langdon movies, yep. The Da Vinci Code, Angels and Demons, Inferno.
I've heard those movies were not good, but hey.
My family liked the first one, Da Vinci Code. I've never seen it all the way through, but it looks boring. And I heard it was boring. And
But Tom Hanks, I freaking love Tom Hanks. He's one of the greatest actors alive. He perfect. He literally is Mr. Rogers.
And then
that's a big compliment.
But in terms of, like, those are the main performances that really stood out to me. But the story is very well told. Again, it's Baz Luhrmann, so you're gonna have that flashy, quick editing and all the other stuff. But this movie is about 2 hours and 40 minutes. It's exactly 2 hours and 40 minutes, but it doesn't feel like 2 hours and 40 minutes. To me, it felt like only 2 hours long. It did. For such a long movie, it felt really short. So that means the pacing was excellent throughout, because it makes you care about the characters. And because it's so fast in terms of the editing, it feels like nothing should have been, like, there's maybe a handful of scenes that could have been cut, but not a lot. That's how good the editing is. It's really, really great. And the sound mixing and sound editing and sound design, you feel like, especially if you have a Dolby Atmos surround sound like I do, you really feel like you're there at his concerts. It's really, really, really good. The story, again, like I said, is very well told. It shows about his life and stuff, about, you know, when he was growing up in, I forgot, what was it, Georgia? Was he from Georgia or was he from Tennessee? I think he was from Tennessee. Feel free, if any Elvis enthusiasts wants to correct me, go right ahead. Because remember, I saw two movies in the same day. But they show his backstory. They show his relationship with Tom Parker. And then his wife, Priscilla, when she enters the picture. By the way, the person who plays Priscilla is the girl from The Visit. I'm not joking. That's the girl from The Visit. I was like, when's Skittles gonna show up?
What do you think, Don?
But she was very good. She was way better in this than in The Visit. What'd you say, David?
I was asking how come you made that compliment about Tom Hanks being Mr. Rogers?
Because he's a descendant of Mr. Rogers. He's literally related to him.
That's true. And he was born to play that role.
And he played that role. And he's literally related to Mr. Rogers.
That's true. Even he was surprised about that.
It's very true. And then they also go into details about certain parts of his career. Like, for example, his Christmas special. There's a huge section about his comeback / Christmas special. It's really, really good. How it gets you that full insight to what was going on behind the scenes in terms of that, and how the producers handled the show, because Parker was being a piece of shit to Elvis and trying to dictate and make it, oh, it's a Christmas special, even though he wanted to make something more than just a Christmas special. He wanted to get, because it was during a low point in his career, so he was trying to get himself back up to mainstream. So that whole section, it's like 30 minutes out of the movie, and it's very, very good. And then we also got his Vegas residency, which is when the movie kind of goes real crazy. Like, it's very dramatic. It's very sad towards the end when you see him, like, die because of a heart attack and all this other stuff. It's based on a real life. I'm not fucking spoiling anything. We all know he's dead. But
Think of it as the Selena movie.
Yeah, it's the Selena movie. Well, the Selena movie and the Elvis movie are so different movies, though. Like, because it's Baz Luhrmann. You see, he has a style. The Selena movie is pretty straightforward.
Different movies, different people.
Yeah, exactly. Different movies, different people. Because we're dealing with rock and roll and we're dealing with Latin pop. You know? Two different genres. And it flies by. It's very entertaining. It hits all the emotions that it wants to, you want to feel, like you want to feel happy. It's, you know, cheering at one moment, upset and depressed by the end. But by the same time, this movie's a beautiful tribute to Elvis himself. It really shows Baz Luhrmann really understood who he was, understood that relationship with Tom Parker, and what all the bullshit he was doing to him and manipulating him and all this other stuff. And his father also manipulated him too, because his father was actually a piece of shit too.
It's very hard to understand each other.
But also, and the soundtrack is obviously very good. Although here's my main complaint with this movie. Alex actually mentioned it when he was doing his review of Austin. He actually mentioned this. If he's in the chat, he mentioned this as well. There's a couple of sections in this movie where they play rap music. Because it's Baz Luhrmann, he did the same thing with The Great Gatsby. Where we put rap music. It does not fit with the movie whatsoever. I understand what Baz Luhrmann was trying to go for by adding the rap music, because these rap artists were also inspired by Elvis Presley. He was so influential, and they want to give these people time to, you know, pay tribute to these artists, but it just doesn't work for me. Have your covers, that's fine, but with rap shit, I don't know, man. It just doesn't fit with me. It doesn't fit. I understand exactly what they were going for by putting some of the rap artists on the soundtrack, but at the same time, it does not fit with when you watch it in the, maybe by itself, but you listening to the songs by themselves on the soundtrack album, maybe it's fine, but with the context of the movie, it doesn't fit. To me, it just doesn't fit. I understand what they were going for, but it didn't work for me. But other than all, that's it. Like, Elvis is such a great film.
I am not a big fan of The Great Gatsby.
The we're talking about the Leonardo DiCaprio one, The Great
Gatsby. That's the one. I did not like that movie.
But
if few people like it, then that's fine.
But other than that, Elvis is such a great film. It does a great job dealing with his life, like his family members, like Priscilla saw the movie. I know Riley Keogh is related to Elvis Presley. She's from Mad Max Fury Road and The Devil All the Time, and she a couple other movies, and the Girlfriend Experience TV show for the first season. She's done a couple of things. She's related to Elvis, and she really enjoyed this. Priscilla likes the film a lot. Like, the family fully supports this movie. So if they support the film and the finished product and really understood what Baz Luhrmann was going for, you know they you have something special. So, yeah. I would highly recommend Elvis. It's a 4.5 out of 5 for me. Again, the 5 was because... why is it not 5 out of 5? It's because of the rap stuff. But other than that, it's a great film. If you have HBO Max, it's streaming there now. I would highly recommend it. It's awesome.
Or you could just watch it in the theaters. Don't give HBO Max their support.
Or you could pirate it.
Well, it's not legal, but well, you're doing yourself a favor.
By the way, how is Tom Hanks related to Mr. Rogers?
They're cousins.
Like, they're cousins, like 3 times removed, 4 times removed, something like that. But they're kind cousins.
Kind of like me with the famous princess.
Famous who?
Princess.
Princess Diana.
You're related to Princess Diana?
Mm-hmm.
I had no fucking idea.
My great cousin, he worked at Disney.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
That's crazy. Yeah, what a twist. As a person who is not a big fan of Disney, a relative worked at Disney. Yeah, wow. Hypocrisy and the irony.
Hiccup.
I love that character in How to Train Dragon.
Oh, shut the fuck up.
By the way, this show is us learning the colors of the United States. Red, blue, and white.
Well, I always wear a white shirt, except for when I actually try to do something different.
even though today is a Mexican Independence Day, but okay, I'll let it slide.
David, you have a topic? I'm done.
Yes, and it's my topic. Anyway, so I was trying to think of something to talk about, and I thought, you know what? Why not talk about a movie I saw last week of Turning Red?
Oh, that's right. I completely forgot about that. It's funny that we mentioned this shit last week, too.
Hey, thanks, Mr. Enter. Nor- hey, Mr. Enter, why we ever compared this movie to 9/11?
I don't get the point of that comparison.
Go ahead, give me reasons.
In Canada. That's not even... Yes, New York here, you takes 3 hours to get to Canada, but it's in fucking Toronto.
Go ahead, buddy, explain. I'll gladly beat your ass.
Oh my god, he's so stupid, too. I don't like him.
Fuck that guy. He's one of the most mean-spirited people you'll ever meet in your life.
It's like I said, it's like those people I was mentioning at the beginning, the people who do, you know, being condescending and having their own, you know, not respecting other people's opinions about other movies. Everybody likes their everybody has their rights to their own thoughts, and you could actually like a movie that some people don't. So shut the fuck up, Mr. Enter, please. Let people like what they like. Thank you very much. This is a public service announcement from Cal Victor.
Account. So as you all know, Turning Red came out March 1st, 2022. Who here has seen the movie?
I.
That's it.
What? I saw the movie like not too long after it came out on Disney Plus.
No, I meant for this guy. Has.
He hates Disney. Of course you're not going to watch it, even though it's a Pixar movie.
It's been a while since I renewed my Disney Plus subscription.
I have it still. You wonder why we did Monsters, Inc.
That's true. What a great Disney start. Plus.
And I was going to use Star Wars for Disney Plus, but then I wanted to watch the uncut version, so I had to find it elsewhere.
That's the best way to go.
Yes. So, as you know, Turning Red...
it is a Pixar movie. We're not going to call it a Disney movie. Even though Disney made the movie, it's a Pixar. Disney and Pixar are two different things, damn it.
Mm-hmm. And this came out March 1st, 2022. And I got to say about this movie, it is an hour and 40 minutes long. It's a family comedy movie. A lot of people liked it. It's one of the most popular movies of all time for this year.
This is one of the it's funny that you mentioned that, because this movie was a complete pop culture phenomenon this year. You couldn't escape the internet without, like, not even a tenth of a second without seeing something from Turning Red, especially Ahuga.
Oh god. So what this movie is about is about a panda. Which...
It's not about a panda. It's about a fucking 13-year-old girl who turns into a panda. Get it right!
That's what I meant.
And it's a red panda. It's not an actual panda. It's a red panda. Get it right!
It's about this...
About culture this 13... swine.
It's about this 13-year-old girl who founds out that... She turns into a red panda, and seeing get scared at the beginning of what's going on. And then
not to mention she has to deal with puberty, and she has to do the puberty, her strict mother, as well as she wants to get tickets for 4Town. 4Town is the boy band in this movie.
Oh,
like Backstreet Boys or NSYNC, although their logo looks more like NSYNC, but
yeah. So she got scared in the beginning, and of course her friends came in, and because of the band, and
because they want to go too.
Yeah. And then it won. The girl,
May, it's her name.
May, thank you. May, actually found out that this is a history of part of the family.
It's a mythology. It's the X-Files. It's the fucking convoluted mythology of the X-Files.
So they do that, and of course, she goes to school, and.
And she deals with real life shit too.
Yes, shenanigans happens there. She tries to learn the process of how to try to live that way. And then there one seemed really wanted to go to the band, started a little charity fund because she found that she actually likes being independent because it makes her money with being popular.
Because it's like, think of it this way. You know how at Disney World, people make shit ton of money off of mascots, or in Times Square with the anti-Semitic Elmo?
Mm-hmm.
Or the other costume characters in Times Square where they all make money because tourists are there? It's similar to that case, but it's only in her school because people like the panda and they think it's so cute.
What are you doing?
Dare have to mention that name.
Who?
Freaking
oh, Elmo. Yeah. I said Elmo, but I also said anti-Semitic, so. That guy hates Leapfrog, and the anti-Semitic Elmo is actually real, and his name is Adam Sandler. I'm not joking. His name is Adam Sandler. He has no relation. He has no relation to you know who.
Oh, my God. So where was I? So you know, she tries to live how to live at school with the panda, and then starts a charity, and that's how she got used to it, liked it and everything. And then later on in the movie, she really wants to go to the band, but
you just said that.
I just thought it's trap because you guys were so she wants to go to the band. However, some kid invites her to a birthday party or whatever, and then and so they decided to go to the park, but they did not realize until later on that it was actually on the same day as the
that concert. Party scene is daring for a kid's movie, but I really enjoyed that. Especially the song they chose. They had the balls to put freaking Destiny's Child on that fucking thing.
So then after that, they go to the concert, and then, of course, it's almost the end of the panda day or
phase.
Yeah, and of course, her mom found out about May sneaking out, and then she turned this into this big panda, and May was talking about, oh, I want to be like in the panda, I love big crowds, and then of course there's a fight scene about that, and then the mom almost died,
Well, so, first of all, you forgot to mention that the mother turns into a panda.
Yes.
Into a red panda. You didn't mention that.
Yes, she turns into the panda. That's why I call it the fight scene.
And the fight scene? You're being unspecific. It's almost like if she was the panda and she was just the mother, it would fucking follow her and the movie would be over.
I don't know about that, but... So... We got that. The mother almost died, but... they finally were able to get her into the circle. And then... May met up with her mama... With her mom and... In the forest place.
I like to think of it as like, it's between, how am I going to explain this correctly? You're giving away the whole fucking movie, but I'm going to say this anyway. It's like this life and death kind of stuff. Like, it's like in between, it's like limbo. That's what it is. It's a limbo that happens to be in a forest. This forest is limbo between humans and red pandas.
Yep, and then, should I say the rest of the movie?
Go ahead, you ruined most of it.
Well, I was just
and also, people have, a lot of people have already seen this movie to begin with. It's a phenomenon for a reason.
Yeah, plus I was just trying to explain what the movie is about, so.
Well, at least with my movie, it was a biopic, so we knew what was going to happen at the end.
And then, after, all the relatives, went back to the regular world. And then, but, she wanted to,
Still wanted to keep being a red panda. That's pretty much what you're trying to say.
She wanted to stay the panda, and then... That's the movie.
That's not the movie. Like, she just becomes a red panda, and her mother actually accepts her at the end. You forgot to mention that. She accepts her at the end for who she is. She gained her independence, and she gained her trust. And she's proud to be half human, half red panda, and she makes more money now because of her mother's workplace. Now she makes even more money for being a freaking red panda because of tourist attractions. Just like in... fucking Times Square, and she does eventually get to 4Town. That's another thing you forgot to mention, because 4Town actually helps in the fight too. You forgot to mention that 4Town actually helps in the fight scene, which is kind of funny.
Yeah. So basically, this movie is all about.
And will you leave it or not? Before you finish, the 4Town songs were co-composed by Billie Eilish. I'm not even joking, but let me tell you something. For once, she did a good song. It wasn't even performed by her. She wrote it, but she didn't perform it. For once, she did a good song. Not even No Time to Die, even as good as a film that wasn't even a good song. This is her best material, and she didn't even perform it. That says something.
Yeah, Billie Eilish, the not so successful sister of Tourette's guy.
that's my A+ coming up today. When this movie was over, I was like, this is spectacular. Because this movie...
It's probably the best animated film I've seen all year, I think. I haven't seen Lightyear. Keep that in mind. I want to watch Lightyear.
Lightyear's good.
You know why this movie was spectacular? Unlike the movie North, this movie had a bunch of, excitement, like towards the end, and it had humor in the movie,
and it had an ending. There wasn't a cop out dream.
It had an actual ending. It actually had common sense throughout the movie of what this movie was about.
Also, it does a better job trying to show how May was trying to defy her parents and show she's more than just who she is. She wants to be herself. Yeah. North was just a fucking asshole.
Yeah, like, this movie is about showing people that you get to just be yourself, be independent, and do what you like to do.
And it's about the teen life, like the early teen life. It does a better job than most A24 movies, in my opinion, depicting that. I don't like A24, but more power to you if you do.
Well, the only movie I've seen was The Disaster Artist. That's
their best. Mm-hmm. Along with Room, and maybe another one that I'm not thinking of right now. Uncut Gems, that's right.
Uncut Gems.
So, this movie, very spectacular one, but
also beautifully animated. It's one of the best looking animated films in a very long time.
It's Pixar. What do you expect?
I know, but at least they're better than fucking Illumination animation.
Oh wow, another rhyme.
Oh, wonderful. To be fair, I hated the Minions movie, Rise of Gru, but the movie was actually for Illumination film was very well animated, shockingly.
Now I'm not sure how long this movie was in production.
It's been since it's an animated film, it takes like 4 or 5 years to make.
So probably.
I don't think it has like a rough production like The Good Dinosaur.
No. I think the director, Dami Shi, she made the movie she wanted to make.
So maybe 2018?
Around that time. I'm going to say maybe 2018, 2019, depending on...
I know she did that that short movie about the dumpling.
That's
Bao.
The short film Bao was for, attached to, I think it was Inside Out.
Incredibles 2.
Never mind. Incredibles 2. What the fuck did I think Inside Out for? That came out in 2015. I think you're thinking
about the one with the volcano.
Oh. The fat volcano. It's Volcano. The movie Volcano with Tommy Lee Jones.
Hello, Tyrannosaurus Island.
2018.
Oh, God. The freaking dinosaur.
2018. Where has the time come?
And also, you could argue it was only in production by that time in 2018. Maybe this could have been developed even further back.
Mm-hmm.
Animated films take a very long time to make. Unless you're, again, Illumination, where you crunch that shit. Now, Illumination films usually take 2 years to make.
Yeah.
But Disney and Pixar usually takes 3 to 4.
So, with this movie, I'm going to give it a 5 out of 5.
I give it a 4.5 out of 5. Yes, I gave it a 4.5 out of 5. What do you want me to fucking tell you? Not everything's going to be a 5 out of 5, David. You should know that.
Yeah.
I know, but...
Look at Elvis. I gave it a 4.5 out of 5 because of the rap shit.
Well, that's better. So, there you go. That is my review of Turning Red.
Good, yay!
Can we go home now?
No! We have a review to do.
Oh, ho, ho, ho.
You want to know the commercials I picked out first?
Oh, wait, I can't.
And they all relate to the movie in some way, shape, or form. These commercials I picked out, they relate to the movie in every shape or form because they're either referenced in the movie or they're referenced somewhat in the movie. One of the commercials isn't directly referenced, but the rest are the other two that I picked out. Well, there's 4 commercials about to be airing right now. Mm-hmm. One of them doesn't have anything to do with the movie. I just put it in there just for shits and giggles. 2 of them have to relate to the movie, and 3rd is not directly referenced in the movie, but it does sum up with the movie in terms of one of the jokes. So I guess I'll say on behalf of everybody, we'll be right back, ladies and gentlemen.
Somewhere in the world right this minute, your soulmate is out there.
The first time I saw her, I said, she is beautiful. This is going to be a great first date.
I felt myself falling in love with him, watching him talk and just thinking, wow, this is all really happening.
When 2 soulmates meet for the first time, it's a powerful experience.
She felt like a friend who I had known for years.
When we first met, the thing that really blew me away is when I heard her voice.
It's one of the nicest memories I think I've ever had.
It just flowed. It fell into place enough for me to say that I had gone on my last first date.
We didn't want our first date to end.
Without a doubt, my most romantic
date ever.
Yeah, absolutely.
Log on to eHarmony and begin the exciting journey to your soulmate by getting your compatibility profile, a $50 value, yours free when you log on to eHarmony.com. eHarmony.com. Log on today. Well, early kiddly, pit rice, pit pump, pit pump, pit pump, pit pink, pit pump, pit pink, pit pump, pit rope, pit throw, pit slow, pit alley, pit oops, pit oops. This way, pit that way, pit daddy, pit baby, pit ain't that way, pit go, pit go. Step, pit, skip, pit, swamp, pit, hug, pit, spin, pit, bike, pit, hike, pit, yikes, pit, wee, pit, wolf, pit, holly, pit, find your pit, it's all pit.
On nights when dad works late, we'll treat ourselves a bit. At Olive Garden.
Ooh, breadsticks.
It's a chance for us to catch up.
So is Donna still in the picture?
Maybe.
Enjoy Olive Garden's new chicken crostata, grilled marinated chicken breast with our tomato Alfredo sauce. Or new steak crostata, grilled steak medallions with a four cheese sauce, both with crispy Asiago cheese crostatas and unlimited salad and breadsticks.
So is this serious?
Yeah, this is seriously good.
Oh. Olive Garden, when you're here.
You forgot about Whatchamacallit!
Gobbledygook. What's its face?
Whatchamacallit.
Whatever it is, whatever it was. Chocolatey chocolate.
Whatchamacallit.
How's it go? Wowzamadoo. Chew-gooey caramel.
Whatchamacallit.
Doohickeys. You know what I mean. Peanutty crispies.
Chewy, chocolatey, crunchy,
unchewy. Doodad. Let's get a Marie. More than a mouthful. It's Whatchamacallit.
Whatchamacallit.
I know what a whatchamacallit is called, a mouth present. Okay, finally, it's my show now. We got ourselves a good review. We got ourselves a good review tonight, and we're gonna be doing Sonic the Hedgehog or Sonic the Hedgehog. As if I'm waiting for David to put the rest of us back on under call. Yeah, bring him back. You don't expect me to do this on my own. Bring him. Bring him back. We gotta get SpongeBob back.
Go to bed.
Why did you call me SpongeBob?
I'm not 12. I'm not a 5-year-old.
Go to bed.
Says the one who's talking. Who's a minor?
Who's the one who looks like a 12-year-old?
I'm not a 12-year-old. I'm an 18-year-old. Get your math right now.
You look like you're fucking 12. Wait to fucking do the intro shit. I didn't even bring up the fucking shit that I always bring up. Oh my god, I'm an idiot. I have to do it real quick before I even fucking go forward with this shit. I knew I was forgetting something before we did this video, but I'm gonna get it in right now. Oh my god, I'm an idiot. Oh my god, I'm sweating like shit brains again, even though it's not fucking North anymore. But anyway, I'm gonna do the statistic shit that I always do. Tonight's movie is Sonic the Hedgehog 2020. This movie is a 2020 action-adventure comedy film based on the Japanese video game series from Sega. It's directed by Jeff Fowler. Screenplay was by Pat Casey and Josh Miller. Again, based on the video games from Sega. Produced by Neil H. Morowitz, who's best known for producing the Fast and Furious movies. He also produced the I Know What You Did Last Summer movies, even though there's only two I Know What You Did Last Summer movies. There's no third one. Fuck that direct-to-video shit. And there's no fucking TV show either. And it's also produced by Toby Merce, Asher, whatever.
Ashton Kutcher?
Tohoru Nakahara and Takashi Ito, and it stars James Marsden, Ben Schwartz, Tika Sumpter, and Jim Carrey. Cinematography is by Stephen F. Winden, who actually shot some of the Fast and Furious films, believe it or not. Edited by Stacey Schroeder and Deborah Neal Fisher. Music was by Chunky XL, a.k.a. Tom Hilkenberg. and it was released by Paramount Pictures and produced by Zeb along with Sega Original Film, which is Marowitz's company, Marza Animation Planet, and Blur Studio. And it was released on February 14th, 2020, right before the pandemic happened. It was the last big hit before the pandemic. It's 99 minutes long. The budget, with the reshoots, because this movie was reshot, if we want to talk about that, we could talk about that. It cost, with the reshoots, it cost $85 to $90 million, and at box office, it made a total of $320 million worldwide. And in terms of reception, has a 63% rating on Rotten Tomatoes. On Metacritic, has a 47 out of 100. As an A on CinemaScore. And I don't know what it is on IMDb, but I'm not even going to bother to look.
I think it's like a 5 out of 10, like they always do.
Probably a 6. They always do 6s now. But anyway, that's... Oh, wait, I forgot to mention the fucking plot of this movie. I'm an idiot. Get Letterboxd open. I'm going to hurry the fuck up. Yeah, and I love this. It's my Letterboxd, too, when I'm done.
I hope this show ends before 2 a.m. because I want to go to bed.
2 a.m.? We're barely got started with the review. You're not going to rush us, David.
But you keep telling me go to bed.
You should be the one saying that.
You're the one who suggested that we should do like bulb the movie and the show.
Yeah, it's your fucking idea. Hurry up. The premise is this. Based on the global blockbuster video game franchise from Sega, Sonic the Hedgehog tells the story of the world's speediest hedgehog as he embraces his new home on Earth. In this live-action adventure comedy, Sonic and his new best friend team up to defend the planet from the evil genius Dr. Robotnik. No, it's not his name. His name is Eggman! And his plans for world domination. Has a 2.9 rating on Letterboxd.
Pingosh.
So who wants to go first? David, you want to go first?
Mm-hmm.
You want to go first? You want to review the movie first?
Sure. This movie was...
My ears!
What?
My ears are sweaty.
Oh. I was going to say, I hope I... My audio. But anyway, this movie was very... This movie was very interesting and fun to watch. You know, Sonic, he's a weird character in this movie.
You said he was a weird character? You're weird.
Yeah. Look at that, you're wearing blue.
Ah! You're weird.
And look at that, I'm wearing red. Oh my god.
And I'm wearing white!
I am freaking Eggman. I am Jim Carrey.
Okay, so now...
Well, it looks like I'm Mario.
Okay, Boris, so you're Goku, Kermit, the Grinch, and Eggman now.
There are top four characters I relate to.
Wow.
So, yes. So, of course, this movie came out in 2020 in the winter. An hour and 39.
Hey, minutes. I just said that. Don't do my job. I already did what I had to do.
I'm not gonna say what
I covered the runtime.
But how long is it again?
1 hour 39 minutes.
Okay, thank you, Victor.
And that's with credits.
And the post credit scenes. Spoiler alert. Credits.
Yeah. Way to be Kevin Feige. We gotta continue that sequel bait post credit scene tradition.
Well, why am I saying spoilers? So it was, I think like a day before the movie came out, like there was already a video of that.
Wow, it got leaked? Shit.
Yeah. as expected from like new releases.
Oh jeez.
I gotta say, this movie was very cool to watch. Is it time for ratings or a bar go?
Wait a minute, you're done?
That's it?
Yeah.
David, you go on for longer. You better talk. You're a talk boy. You haven't talked all day. You talk, boy. Be more specific.
You want me to talk?
Yes.
Okay, I'll talk. So, this movie, it had a lot of action in it. Sonic found his best friend, and...
What? Who am I? Who? How long has that been there?
Oh, now you just noticed.
You know what? Yeah.
I know who I am. I know who I am. I'm David Spitch.
Oh, God.
There. That's better.
What I was trying to say was, so Sonic meets his best friend.
Tom Wachowski. His name is Tom Wachowski. I wonder if he's related to the Wachowski sisters.
Is there a developer on Sega named Wachowski?
I don't know.
If that were the case, that's a brilliant inside joke. I'll get to that later.
Yes. And of course, he meets his best friend, and they do all crazy stuff, and Sonic also wanted to see a party, which is not meant for people under 18.
It's just like you.
The party I'm when 18. They were in the fucking motorcycle people?
Yeah.
That's Sons of Anarchy shit right there.
And also I'm going to say, the crazy thing about, this part of the movie was the of how they freeze the actual scene.
Asshole.
No, on how they actually frozen the scene.
Oh, yeah. You could have just said that Sonic actually stopped time.
Yeah, that's what I meant.
Yeah, he turned into fucking Quicksilver. You're not Pietro. If anything, Pietro's dead for when Age of Ultron came out. But this is the different Quicksilver, the fucking Quicksilver from Days of Future Past. So what am I talking about? We're in the X-Men timeline, not the fucking MCU timeline. Anyway.
Honestly, I don't know how they edit that.
It's very simple. If you've ever seen Days of Future Past, we stop it. It's all CGI, where you stop it, you stop the thing, and then you kind of... Maybe they actually had to let them, freeze. They actually had to freeze up.
Yeah.
Sometimes they do that.
Yeah. And also, Eggman in this movie was very funny.
What do you expect from Jim Carrey? He's going to deliver every time, except for maybe the number 23.
Oh, God.
Or Dark, what was that movie? Dark Crimes that got really bad reviews.
Mm-hmm. So
me, myself, and Irene.
I heard that's actually not that bad.
It's not my favorite Jim Carrey movie.
But I guess the Farrelly Brothers. It's gonna be if you don't like the Farrelly Brothers, But he did Dumb and Dumber for them, so.
Now that's a good one.
So. I mean, that movie was very great to watch. It had a lot of great choices, in it, including the part about Will Smith.
That one didn't age quite so well. I'll get to David. That. speaking of bitch slap.
Keep your husband's name out your fucking mouth, okay?
Love you.
I caught him there.
If people think I'm actually gay, no, I'm just joking around.
I'm like someone. You go next.
No,
you
no,
still
no.
Done. You didn't even do your fucking score yet.
That's true.
I'll give it a 5 out of 5.
That's bullshit. That you gave a 5 out of 5 for almost every single thing on the show except for North. You better lower that fucking grade. This was not a 5 out of 5.
Okay, I'll give it a 4 out of 5. Is that better?
That sounds better to me. But but did you go over how good the effects looked? Because Sonic is CGI. Oh my God,
yeah. The effects in this movie, like,
and the drones and shit.
This better take, took like a bunch of years in order to do that. Like, seriously.
Well, they had to do reshoots. All one of us is gonna get to that.
I wasn't even trying to scare him.
Anyway, my final score, 4 out of 5.
Good, that sounds better. Who wants to go?
This guy. After shenanigans.
Oh boy. What do I gotta say about this movie? I guess I could give a little bit of background about this movie. This movie had a pretty long production.
The production, I think, went fine, but it's the marketing that fucked it up.
There was
like, actual filming, everything was fine. But when in post-production, shit.
Well, yes, this is technically the first Sonic movie that was released in theaters. This isn't the first time. This is the first time he tried to be in theaters. At one point in the 90s, there was supposed to be like a live-action Sonic movie, but due to rewrites and creative differences, it was canceled.
They were trying to make another Sonic movie in the 90s. I did not know that.
Oh, yeah. Actually, you can literally read the script on the Lost Media Wiki. It's bizarre.
Gotta be better than Super Mario Bros. The
93
movie.
Yeah, that's coming out next year.
And then
what about the 1993 live action movie?
Oh.
That movie is fucking just, I don't get, that movie's just weird.
Yeah.
So weird.
Yeah. Valiant and Mario and Sid the Sloth as Luigi. There's their movie.
And Yoshi doesn't even look like Yoshi. He looks like a freaking dinosaur from Jurassic Park. Not the cute dinosaur we know him as.
And then at one point there was gonna be an animated Sonic movie based on the Sonic the Hedgehog anime TV show. No,
Sonic
not the penis
X?
One.
Oh, that show I didn't.
No,
really
no,
like.
No, no, not that one. Not that one. The other one.
Sad AM.
No, no, not the pingus one.
Sad AM. The other one that was for ABC. The one that the Archie comics eventually
that's
continued.
That's the one.
That's Sad AM.
However, that one also has a pretty complicated production, and to the point where there
was like Deke and going through all that shit, like when they got bought out by Disney. Remember when they got bought out by Disney? I know.
Oh yeah, and then at one point, like a DreamWorks was at no, not when I mean DreamWorks, I don't mean the shrunky DreamWorks.
I mean the regular DreamWorks division, the one with the black, the purple background with the kid fishing on the river, not the fucking balloon shit.
No, I'm not talking about a Shrek. Yeah,
DreamWorks Pictures. We're not talking DreamWorks Animation.
Yeah, well, yes.
Two different divisions, guys.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. They were gonna pass it on to DreamWorks. However, they also
they got
did.
Bought out by Paramount. That's what happened?
Yep, and they basically didn't want. Yeah, and they basically didn't want anything to do with the movie. And then here we are today.
Well, first off, you got to mention that Sony Pictures was supposed to do this movie.
Originally,
yeah, Todd Rothman.
Originally, Sony was going to do them. Actually, it was actually announced during the
because
Sony.
Because they had a deal with Original Film. They worked with Original Film several times. The production company, Neil H. Morowitz's company. They did the I Know What You Did Last Summer movies with them. They did 2003 SWAT movie with them. They did the 21 and 22 Jump Street movies with them and MGM. They did Stealth with them. The emo plane himself.
Oh, God.
And they did another movie with them, a couple other movies with them, but that's the ones that really come to mind in terms of what they made with Sony. But it was only a Sony production because it was under them. They had a deal with them, but then they transferred their deal to Paramount.
To Paramount. And then what happened then?
Filming went well. Like, the filming went well, and then... MPC Vancouver, I don't know what the fuck were you thinking. MPC, I don't know what they were thinking with that. That and horrible then, design.
And then the trailer came out with this. And as you expected, there were a lot of backlash. To the point...
It looked ugly.
It was probably one of the most disgusting things I've ever seen in my life. It was this close on being on one of the top 10 worst movies based on video games. And
if they kept that design, yes.
And then something unpredictable happened.
I think it's mainly because of this. Listen, Jeff Fowler, the director, he knew something was wrong, and they
asked Paramount
to delay the movie so they could get the NPC back in there and do Sonic again. And to his credit, it worked.
Yeah, and then something unpredictable happened. They actually heard our cries. And Jeff Fowler says, you know what? Don't worry. We're going to fix it.
Jeff Fowler understands. He's not one of those Hollywood hacks who just condescends everybody, who, you know, makes fun of people who hate him. He's the one who, one of the ones who accepts the criticism and tries to make the best movie he can. Bless Josh Fowler. He gets people. He gets it.
So pretty much he went from this to this.
Although that shot's very unflattering. I'm going to say that shot looks fucking ugly. When he's screaming like that.
So I was actually surprised on actually them fixing the design. And actually, when I watched the second chair, I was impressed.
And then after that, people had more faith in the film. I was kind of skeptical. Like, I was skeptical of the movie from the very beginning. This is back when I was more critical about movies. Now, sort of the open-mindedness that you saw and you've been seeing in this today's episode. But even when the redesign got fixed and I liked the redesign better, I was still skeptical about the movie. Because even with the fixed design, you have to have a good script, first and foremost.
And clean.
But shockingly, this is a good script.
Yeah.
And then, did the movie live up to hype?
It made money!
In a way, actually, yes it did. However,
it was the last hit movie before the pandemic hit. And for a long time, it was the highest grossing movie of the year. Or no, Bad Boys for Life was the highest grossing movie of the year. What I'm talking about, because of the fucking, it made more money than Sonic overall, but still made a lot of money. And then it took until Spider-Man No Way Home to be an actual another big hit at the box office.
When did that one came out?
No Way Home came out December 2021.
Last year.
Mm-hmm. Well, set 9 months ago, because it's a very late 2021 release.
Mm.
Yeah.
And I'm not going to lie, I actually really did enjoy this movie. For me, I think it's...
Well, I do too.
Mm-hmm. Now, well, I think, well, I won't... Here's the thing, I kind of overhyped it a little bit, maybe because this is a perfect palate cleanser after watching North.
I mean, it's like going from rock bottom to Candyland, so.
Exactly. And let's get with the, well, I think we already addressed what the story is, but when I was watching the trailer, I was also feeling skeptical, maybe because the story sounds like how the trailer played out. It looks a bit like Hop.
Oh my God. More
funny thing, that one also has James Marsden.
In my opinion. Illumination, I get why they're popular. The kids love them. And you know what? I'm not gonna ruin their fun. Those movies are just not for me, though.
Mm-hmm. However, when I watch the movie, okay, yeah, sure, it basically plays with the live-action guy tagging along.
You know, House is in Hop. The guy who plays House. I think he was in Hop. I could be wrong.
Yeah, he was the fodder.
It's so funny because I started season 2 of House the other day.
Oh my god!
I mentioned House again, 2 weeks in a row.
And okay, so when I was watching the movie, it's not really. I was actually surprised it's not a ripoff of Hop, because how can you rip off a bad movie? But it does basically tags along with the.
It's a bit typical. It's a bit predictable. It's a family film. It has that kind of cliches about it, but with that being said, it plays around with it a little bit.
Yeah, it basically tags. The story is not really that new. It's one of those
you've
movies
seen
where
this before.
The animated character traveling in a live action world, and he has to tag along this live action human, and off they go to a sailor adventure. We've seen this many times before. Some of them worked. Some didn't, but here, it surprisingly really worked. It's not really much of a. The movie doesn't really base on the games. The only time where it actually does base on the games is mostly just like the references and the little inside jokes.
I think it is faithful to the games, but I'll get to that in a moment. Because the thing is that Sonic, the original Genesis games, don't really have plots. You kind of have to make up a lot of shit.
Exactly, and. However, you have a really generic story. How is the execution? Surprisingly well.
Yeah.
Like I won't even lie that the journey was actually quite entertaining. You actually do want to see like what Sonic and the human character Tom is gonna be up are gonna
Tom
either...
Wachowski. Mike Wazowski!
I just made a Wazowski joke earlier. You do want to see those two characters on just traveling on different places or traveling on either traveling on another city or just going on different locations.
Yeah.
It's a road trip movie in some similarities, some ways.
And then you got the characters themselves. The movie mostly focused on, in a way, actually three characters. Tom himself, Sonic, and Eggman, or as the movie called him, Robotnik.
And the rest of the human characters don't really have a role in the movie. They're just kind of there. Especially Tom's
generic.
Girlfriend. She kind of just is there.
They're mostly generic. I mean,
they're there to serve something, but it's like it's predictable, and they don't really have dimension to them. To me, they could have tightened that up a little bit more and make me care about them more. We'll see how they do with the sequel if we ever get to it. But
the only one that seems to background character that seems to have like the most
it's the
like,
sister of the girlfriend. She has sister- personality.
Her and then the girlfriend herself. Yeah. I think they're like the only ones that seems to have like the most like character, but even at that,
the guy who was one of the cops, he looked like fucking Dewey from Scream. He was acting like Dewey. And I'm saying as a Scream fan, he was kind of just eccentric.
Well, so basically the girlfriend's family seems to be the only ones that have like the most character, but even with that, they only have like a couple minutes of screen time, which I'm not too upset about.
I'm not too upset about that either. You could cut them out completely and it wouldn't make a difference.
When there's a movie called Sonic the Hedgehog, you expect the movie to be about Sonic, and...
No, it's Godzilla 2014!
And it delivered very well, since we actually do get like an origin story of Sonic. We actually introduce who Sonic's mother was, which is an owl, surprisingly.
Is that Hedwig from Harry Potter? The owl from Harry Potter? Harry's out.
They even mentioned like an old. They even mentioned a Star Wars. They even did a Star Wars joke.
Yeah, Obi-Wan.
I'll get to the humor later. And fuck! I was gonna say something. So they gave it like an origin story of Sonic, which is actually quite sweet in a way. And that's another thing about this movie. It's surprisingly sweet and wholesome. I mean, sure,
it
can be like
a kid movie. What do you expect?
I mean, sure, it can be like really fast paced, no pun intended, and like and just insane. But there are some times where the movie can actually be quite charming, which I was actually genuinely, I am surprised. And what I really do love about Sonic is that they made him like the outcast, the fish out of water, the one who doesn't know where he belongs. And in fact, basically,
the animated character in live action kids movies is always the fish out of water. Think about Stuart Little and Hop to a certain extent.
Actually, you know what? I just thought of this. Hop is basically Sonic the Hedgehog is basically what Hop should have been.
I think. Funny you mentioned that because Hop stars James Marsden. I completely fucking forgot too.
Literally just said that.
Oh my god. I completely forgot he was in that too. And I made a joke earlier about it being possibly a prequel to Enchanted for some reason.
Funny thing, we're gonna get a sequel to Enchanted very soon.
November, around Thanksgiving weekend, I think.
And then you get okay, I actually really do kind of admire how they make Sonic like a really like a vulnerable character where he's mostly just like a loner. He's a lonesome character, and you really do feel bad for him. If it was the ugly of the Sonic, you'd be just laughing.
You want to beat the shit out of him.
And you actually want to see you do really want to see Robotnik actually achieve his goal.
And then you go to the ending, maybe that's the case.
And then you get the character Tom, who at first he basically starts out like basically just another like as expected from those live action like anime like hybrid movies, just the generic of the straight man
who has a girlfriend who is kind of doesn't believe at first that this bird thing exists. Similar to fucking also Neil Patrick Harris from fucking Smurfs. His girlfriend doesn't fucking accept the Smurfs at first, if I remember correctly. The Roger Gosnell movie. I haven't seen the movie in ages, but I heard not.
Hey.
What the hell's wrong with you, David?
Another one, Alvin and the Chipmunks.
The first one's not that bad, though. I'll give him credit. I'll give him credit for the first time.
The second and third one.
A whole lot worse, which they did later on.
But as soon as he unites with Sonic and actually helps Sonic go to Mushroom World.
They don't give it a name. They don't give it a name.
But as soon as
I can't call Mushroom Kingdom because Nintendo would sue me.
Yeah, exactly. Mario and Sonic. Yeah, imagine them uniting.
Olympics.
Yes, and I don't even know what the world is called.
Like they never really give it a name, and I mean Sonic just calls it Mushroom World. But it was actually during that time where we actually do get like a little bit of more depth on Tom. I mean, okay, sure, he's still a little bit generic, but yes, he does show like a little bit of more some more development.
And not to mention, he was supposed to move to San Francisco at the beginning of the movie.
And as soon as he gets to know Sonic, he sort of changes mind in a way, or he goes to a Plan B.
Green Hills, aka fucking Vancouver, British Columbia, Canada. Which is where they shot it. No joke, they shot in Vancouver.
And then we get to
I'm surprised they don't have any Canadian actors in that movie. Shockingly. At least I don't think.
And then we get to this
Jim Carrey's Canadian, but that's besides the point.
What can I say about Jim Carrey? I love the guy. He's one of my biggest inspirations. And
my favorite Dumb and Dumber. By far, Dumb and Dumber. I never seen a sequel, and quite frankly, I don't think I ever will, because that movie's just magic that you can't repeat twice.
I heard the sequel wasn't that good.
Maybe I'll give it a try one of these days, but I'm not in a huge rush to do so.
As soon as I heard that Jim Carrey is going to do Robotnik, I was immediately in. I mean, okay, the movie could be bad, but at least Jim Carrey could save this movie. And he was perfect. And he
ultimately, this was a comeback role, because he had a lot of crap. Like, Kick-Ass 2. In fact, he disowned Kick-Ass 2, and then Dumb and Dumber 2, and Dark Crimes, and then he came back with this. This was like a comeback vehicle for him. That and the Showtime series Kidding, which you might have heard about.
And when you hear Jim Carrey as Robotnik, you don't expect, well, you're not gonna get like Robotnik as like the evil, like the sinister that wants to like kill Sonic. We do get that, but not in a way that
he is basically like himself. Jim Carrey's basically playing himself.
It's Jim Carrey being Jim Carrey, and I fucking love it. Every line that he says, every joke that he makes, the way him, like, his over-the-top acting.
He ad-libbed some of that.
The improv was all perfect and genius. I even like his little I even like his sidekick there. He's also funny.
Mm-hmm.
And then you get, like,
And then you get the villain from Lord Ass 2 in one scene.
Oh,
that's literally Neil McDonough. He always plays bad guys, but in this one, he's only in one scene, or maybe two scenes, and he doesn't do anything.
Thank God, good. And then you get the references of the games, which there are actually quite a lot. Of course, you got Green Hills, which is literally just the first level of Sonic, which is amazing. And then, wake up,
bitch! Wake up!
You're the one who wants to do this late at night.
Yes, you wanted to do this. You thought this was a fucking good idea, bro. I'm awake. It's 2:21 right fucking now. I'm gonna be in bed probably by 3 o'clock in the fucking morning, but I'm still awake compared to you. Wake the fuck up.
Got my question.
And then, okay, so they show them Green Hill, which is obviously the first level of Sonic, and then, of course, the rings are, unlike in the games where, basically, they're just, like, power-ups.
This one, they're like fucking Doctor Strange!
In a way, as soon as, like, Sonic throws a ring, it actually teleports to a different place.
Bro! Is this connected to the Marvel Cinematic Universe? I really want to know. Did Kevin Feige produce this in secret, and he didn't get a credit?
I mean, you got Shrek.
Consider the fucking post-credit scene sequel baits.
I mean, you got Shrek mentioned in She-Hulk.
Shrek. I love Shrek. Awesome.
I freaking love Shrek. And then, of course, there's some of the little insights. Oh my god. To the point they had to mention Sonic.
They mentioned it? I was paying attention second time. I've seen it twice now.
At the beginning of the movie, Sonic is basically giving, like, expositions on, like, on the scene that it takes place.
Summer's movie.
And then there's this one guy who's crazy, and he...
Oh, the blue devil thing! Right.
The blue devil, and what he did...
It's the movie End of Days, but PG, where Arnie faces the devil.
And what does he show? A picture of Sonic. And I was like, oh my god, they did that. there's even more, like, little inside jokes. Let's ask some chili dogs. I'm actually so glad they mentioned chili dogs.
Yeah, and then, speaking of gas, that shit could give you gas.
And then the first word that Sonic says, that gotta go fast, He sniffed drugs. I'm not even joking.
Oh boy. Yeah, Sonic X. That show might as well be on drugs. Shit. I don't know what they were thinking with Sonic X.
And then of course there are the moments where Sonic was actually spinning, was rolling and spinning his, and then spinning himself, and then hits to like a vehicle, which is just really clever. The action is actually really good.
What do you expect from one of the cinematographers who shot some of the Fast and Furious movies?
And they're just as good as those movies.
Well, not like, F9, but that's another story.
Well, some of them. And as for the pacing, the movie is actually really fast paced. No,
well, it's because 98 minutes, and it has the
perfect pacing. I'm not big on like fast paced movies, but they actually did. The pacing here is perfect.
Mm-hmm.
And then as for the jokes, well, it's mostly
hit and miss. Some land, some miss.
Some jokes are really memorable. Mostly some of the things that Sonic would say,
just
or
like
even
any comedy, there could be hit and miss stuff.
Oh, but then the movie relies on pop culture humor.
I think pop culture humor can be funny as long as you do it right.
And here. Almost. Some of the pop culture humor was actually pretty funny. Then some there are mostly just, oh god, really? And then there's, of course, the Will Smith joke that, of course, it aged like milk.
Milk is good for you. It's good for your bones.
Have you ever tried rotten milk?
Yucky.
There you go. And of course there was the gas humor, which I was like, oh god, I have to go there.
Gas humor, farting, burping, always with the toilet humor, guys. We always gotta put it in every kids movie. I'm telling you, stop putting it in kids movies. We know it's gas. David, wake the fuck up.
Well, I got a nitpick. I was kind of sad that Robotnik didn't say pingus, but hey, I'm looking for flaws, and that's not a flaw. That's just stupid little me being
overhyping picky. The movie.
Yeah. But what I got, I'm actually satisfied. Sonic the Hedgehog is a really fun movie. The action is great. The humor at times can be stupid. It's really well written, really well done. The pacing is good. The soundtrack is also pretty good.
I could talk about the score mostly, but the rap shit at the end. Oh my god! Speaking of rap shit,
the score. Well, the score by Junkie XL is actually not that bad.
Tom Hilkenberg, he's one of the best at what he does.
Like the animation, perfect. I'm not just talking about Sonic.
NPC did a very good job. It's mostly done by NPC.
I'm not just talking about Sonic himself. Like the effects are really well done.
Drones.
The beginning of the movie, perfect. How the movie blends like CG and live action, it mixes in amazingly.
It doesn't look fake. It looks well made.
Yeah, it looks very real. Oh, the movie and the rap.
And the acting is well done. It actually does respect to the games, even though it's mostly loosely based on the games. To me, I really did enjoy it. How would I rate this on the Bozo rating scale? From 8++ being the best to 2K20 being the worst, I give it a bumptacular.
which is a 4 out of 5.
Speaking of 4 out of 5, it's my turn. Well, I've already kind of explained my history with this film before, with the marketing and all the other stuff. But when I saw this film for the very first time, it shocked me how good it was. Now, I'm going to tell you something right now. Even though some people say this is the best video game franchise movie of all time, so is the second one. I have not seen the second one.
Detective Pikachu.
Detective Pikachu is the best video game movie of all fucking time. Rob Letterman, he gets it, man. It was clearly made by a fan. Because he understood the material for both Detective Pikachu game and the regular Pokemon games. Regular. I love that movie. It is visually dazzling. Great characters, all that other stuff. We can talk about Detective Pikachu another time. We're talking about Sonic. But Sonic is probably like the second or third place with me in terms of video game films, because there's not a lot of good video game films out there. Let's face it. It's hard to do good video game films. It's hard. Look at the Resident Evil fucking franchise. Paul W.S. Anderson, I don't know what you were thinking, bro. And the TV show made everything worse, but that's besides the point. But in terms of, we're getting it. If you like the TV show, if you like the Paul W.S. Anderson movies, again, fine. Because I know the Paul W.S. Anderson Resident Evil movies has its fans. I know it has a fan base, so. Sonic the Hedgehog, it does what it sets to do. It sets out to do. It does everything it does. It says on in the box art, or in the can, or in the tin, however you want to call it. Jeff Fowler, he understands the material. Even though these games, the first three or so, they don't really have plots. So really, and they're not taking anything from the modern Sonic games, which are, you know, very complicated, divisive. A lot of people, you know, some people have their own thoughts about the modern Sonic games. So they're trying to really capture the classic games, the ones that everybody likes. So, since there's not really much plot in those, they try to, it's a very simple story. Aside from the whole Tom Wachowski thing, it's pretty much like the game. Him versus Robotnik. That's it. That's all it is. It's a simple story, but it's effective. Sometimes simplicity excels, you know? And with the story and everything, yes, it's very predictable. You can predict everything that's going to happen in the first 5 minutes of the movie. But how it gets to that point, how it gets to beat for beat for beat, is a little bit different. I think it's because of the writing. The writing is very sharp for the most part. It's very well written. The jokes are mostly funny. Again, Jim Carrey is a fucking incredible as Robotnik. Excuse me, Eggman. But, I have to give credit where credit is due. Ben Schwartz, who voices Sonic, it's clear he had a passion for it. I think on the audio commentary, he said he wanted to really voice Sonic for a very long time. So, it's clear that he showed a lot of passion when it comes to voicing Sonic.
I'll only say the acting is really well done.
Yes, it is very well done. But him in particular, he kind of makes that character his own. He doesn't try to copy anybody who's voiced him before in the games. He just is himself as Sonic. And you've seen him in voices like in the DuckTales reboot. And you also seen him in that Showtime series House of Lies. It shows that he's a great comedian. So clearly, he was a good choice to get Sonic because Sonic, you know, does a lot of jokes. He's a teenager with attitude, and he's not a Power Ranger. But he does a good job showcasing Sonic the way how he's supposed to be. James Marsden is also very good as Tom. Shows, even though it's, again, not very developed all that much, it shows the bond. He does a good job developing that kind of bond he has with Sonic. It's more of a, like, at first it's like a buddy type thing, but then it becomes a sort of a pseudo father and son type of deal towards the end, where you really see, especially at the ending, when he gets, this is a 2-year-old movie, when he gets his new room and stuff, he moves in with them.
Oh, yeah.
So it's almost like his new family, and they make a joke about that because Fast and Furious, they make a Fast and Furious joke because, oh, it's about family in this way, the irony of two people who worked on the Fast and Furious will be producing this film and referencing Fast and Furious. So, but the visual effects are very, very good. MPC, once again, they do a very good job, you know, especially what they had to go through when it comes to the post-production. They should be commended because they had a lot of shit to deal with. This was after they did the effects for Cats. Yeah.
Oh.
They did the effects for Cats. They are responsible for what those hideous fucking things you saw on the screen. So this was their redemption, in a way. After that horrific. And even with that, the original design sucked, but you know what? They actually did it. And what's fun thing is about that is that they used the ugly Sonic and Chip and Dale Rescue Rangers, the Disney Plus movie, because MPC worked on Chip and Dale. So that's why they brought him in. The director, who was part of the Lonely Island is awesome, by the way. They're awesome. They decided, since MPC's working on this movie, let's put an ugly Sonic in the movie, in Chip and Dale. So it's hilarious how they incorporate that and how meta that is. It's very funny. But going back to this film now, I mean, it's such a simple story. You don't really have too much to say about it, but it's simple and it's straight to the point. It gives people what they want. It's not too complex so the kids will understand. The kids fucking love this movie. You know what I've noticed too? This movie has been repeating on Nickelodeon a lot lately. Almost every day, the kids love this movie. It literally, check the Nickelodeon schedule. It airs almost every day now. I'm not joking. Yeah, Sonic airs almost every day on their schedule. That's how popular that movie is with kids. So clearly, it works well with kids. And it works well with adults, too, because there's a bit of adult jokes in there. They make freaking jokes about colonoscopy.
Oh, man.
And they make jokes about divorce. And all this other stuff. And it's very funny. Again, some of the pop culture jokes don't hit for me. Some of that. But some of the jokes jokes in general don't land. But again, it's a comedy. A comedy's often hit or miss when it comes to jokes. But it hits mostly the right notes that what you want. Action scenes are terrific. Especially towards the end with the San Francisco chase. There's fucking explosions everywhere. Like it's Michael Bay or something. Mm-hmm. And it's just Eggman's just flying, just boom, 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 trying to kill him and destroying all these cars and shit. It's pretty impressive how it looks. And then Sonic goes practically Super Saiyan at the end. I mean, sort of. It's not Super Sonic.
Super Saiyan Blue.
Yeah, it's more blue, but he still kind of goes ape shit at the end. And this was after a Deus Ex Machina where he's, you know, we think he's dead. I'm just like, bro, it's a kid's movie. It's gonna have a Deus Ex Machina. So, but this film is very touching. It's a very heartfelt film. Its heart is in the right place. It's not a mean-spirited film. It's not like it's literally saying fuck you to the fans right in front of your face. Because it respects its fans. And it also respects audiences who want to see a good family film. This is a quality family film.
Every character is likable, believe it or not.
It's a quality
family. Unlike the last one.
Even Robotnik in some ways is likable, even though he's the villain.
He's supposed to be the villain, but you just can't help yourself but love every moment
of whatever he does. You want him to succeed. You want him to succeed just about as much as Sonic. In a way, he does succeed because he fucking knows his way around Mushroom Land or whatever. And then at the end of the movie, when it pulls a Kevin Feige once again, how many times have I roasted Kevin Feige? I apologize. I love the MCU, although I'm not into it that much anymore. Kind of grew out of it. I think it's gone for far too long, but that's besides the point. They pull like a Kevin Feige mid-credit scene. Who pops out of the portal? Doctor Strange-esque thing. It's
Tails.
A guy who has two tails right next to his ass. Tails. They also, funny thing is that they actually got the voice actor from the games to do the voice of Tails, not some celebrity voice. And that's the same thing for the sequel. They got the voice actor for the games. Voice actress. Yeah, it's one of those things where female actresses voice male characters. It's a reoccurring thing in animation, apparently.
Well, technically in anime in Japan.
Huh?
Well, it's mostly common in Japan with anime.
Yeah, but common here too.
That's true.
Tales. Mostly Tales have been voiced mostly by women, actually. But, yeah. It's, you know, you kind of expect Tails to be in the sequel, but at the same time, it's nice to see. I think he looks, even though the Sonic model looks like, Tails looks even better in terms of model design, what NPC did. He looks even better here. And apparently, that's not really the final-ish design as you saw in Sonic the Hedgehog 2. Which, maybe we might get to that someday, I don't know. But, since it came out earlier this year, and it's a powerhouse at the box office, by the way. Sonic 2 did very well. Did even better than the first one. And a lot of people say it is better than the first one, so that's interesting. So, I don't have too much more to say about it. It's a good film. I like it. 4 out of 5 stars.
As for what's next for Sonic, all I gotta say is one thing. Continue?
April 8th, not August 8th, you dumbass. Read that. Oh, April 8th.
Yeah, bro.
Not August 8th.
Yeah, blame the UK release.
UK. Yeesh. But yeah.
I want to see
4 out of 5. I have to add another film onto the wheel. Any suggestions? I almost want to put in Zombies because it's a made-for-TV movie, but I'm going to wait till October.
Finding Dory.
What?
Mimo or Finding Dory?
Mima?
Mimo.
Mima. Mama. Mommy. Poo-poo.
Mimo.
Mama.
Mimo.
Poo-poo. Pee-pee. Cocky. Poo-poo.
Rocky bye, baby. On the top.
Wait, let's see here. I have a couple of things here. Like, I have a couple of lists here on Letterboxd that I have here of... Maybe I should make a list privately for Letterboxd to see, like, any suggestions so we would be more prepared whenever I add stuff to the list. But let me see what kind of...
Actually, you got any recommendations for this week?
What? Oh, yeah. Recommendations? Let's see. My recommendation for this week is... Funny. I've been watching The OC lately. The OC is pretty good. It's a good teen drama. Even though it's not really... People say it's a teen drama. It's more of a family drama. It's not really... Like, it deals with teenagers, but it's like more of a family drama. I've been watching that lately, too, along with House. OC is a pretty good show. That's my recommendation of the week. Because I haven't really watched any movies this week other than Elvis. I mean, Elvis could be a recommendation of the week too, but I already reviewed it. So what's even the point?
You know what? Since you mentioned Enchanted, why not put that one?
Why not? I'm not thinking of anything right now. Let's put that.
All right. Time for me to share my favorite wheel.
Of bullshit. Bullshit.
Threaten shite.
Okay, you already added on there already? I don't see it.
It's right here.
Oh, there you go.
No, I'll talk about Enchant. Oh, there you go. It's better. Okay. You want to spin the wheel now?
I think I might land on Enchanted. What about you guys?
Avatar.
I'm going to say Hunter... If he's watching, he wants me to blend it on Titan AE, so let's put Titan AE for him.
Avatar. Okay. Avatar? Okay. 3, 2, 1. Come on, please be a good one. Well, I'll be damned.
Oh. Yes! It's a good fucking movie for once! Shit! Wait again, let's take it. No, this is a fucking great movie. I have a lot to say about The Bourne Identity because I watched this movie literally 2 months ago. So it's perfect. A great fucking movie, too. It's a good movie. Really, really good. I think you're both going to love it a lot.
Ah. I know John Powell did the score, which I'm a big fan of John Powell.
His score is incredible for this movie.
So
he never made a bad score, and I heard I heard one track.
Born Identity. And I'm in the Moby song.
I heard one track from I think it was actually the second Bourne movie, and wow, that actually got me goosebumps. So I can't wait to see the Bourne Identity. Possibly one of the most iconic Matt Damon movies.
It's one of his best roles, and it made him an action star because he wasn't known for being an action star at the time. He was mostly only doing dramatic stuff. So I'm interested about what you two have to say about it, because it is a very good movie. You really got to pay attention to it, though, because it gets a spy-ish movie, government conspiracy. I'll put it on the subtitles, so you'll be fine. But great. I can't wait to talk about it.
I was so close for Daisy White.
Yeah, so close. Maybe next time, David. Maybe if you don't go, maybe if you didn't fucking fall asleep, it would land on Avatar.
Doesn't make any sense.
My God, it's almost 3 o'clock in the fucking morning. Shit.
I want to thank everybody for watching episode number 5 of the Popcorn Panel. Tune in next week.
For the Bourne Identity. Yes. Yep. Yeah, Bourne Identity. In other words, we might need new identities once this show goes on the air again. So
I do know it's all about a guy who doesn't remember anything. So
speaking of somebody who doesn't remember anything, David.
Yeah, I'll have to forget him.
We're gonna forget him. Let's see. Anything else I have to say? In terms of that, thank you for watching, everybody, and I'll see you guys next time. And stay safe, and not do bad things, and respect others' opinions about movies, and don't be a fucking asshole about it, and judge movies on your own taste and what you like, and don't be fucking with social media. Judge it by what you want, and don't worry about social media. And fuck the Star Wars fan babies. In other words, good night, everybody.
Stay healthy for your birthday tomorrow.
Oh, yeah. You son of a bitch. Good night.